Welcome to the American Academy of Grief Counseling's Videogram on Resiliency and Oscillation in Grief. In this video, we're going to look at factors that determine resiliency in recovery from the grief process itself. So what is resiliency and what is oscillation? In grief, resiliency is one's ability to recover from difficulties, from the trauma, from the loss itself. Certain individuals will recover quicker, while others will take more time for that recovery period. And oscillation plays a huge role in how an individual recovers or how resilient they are themselves. Oscillation refers to the emotional moods of up and down, feeling good or feeling bad. And the more frequent the oscillation during the process of recovering from the actual loss, or I should say the adaptation from the loss, because we never truly do recover. But the oscillation itself becomes less frequent as we become to adjust and become more adapted to the particular loss itself. So in the early phases of loss, oscillation is erratic. We're back and forth. There's no really linear healing from the grief itself. It is more of an oscillation of up and down of various emotions that we are dealing with as we try to learn how to cope and adjust and adapt to that particular loss. But as time progresses, it flatlines a little bit and you see less oscillation in your emotional self. Those who are able to reduce the oscillation rate sooner are able to get a more clear mind and a more adjusted attitude towards life after the loss itself. So the ability to adjust and adapt is key in regards to oscillation and its ability to help us to be more resilient. So how frequent is the oscillation will determine also how quickly we can find ourselves to in a more adjusted state itself. What are some determining factors in our resiliency? Well, obviously, the oscillation rate is going to be determined by the nature of the loss. How severe is the loss itself? Some losses do not affect us as greatly as others. Maybe the death of an acquaintance or a distant family member, the factor of resiliency to recover and to adjust to that particular loss isn't going to be as severe. If we lose someone that's very close to us, has a huge impact in our particular life, well, then that nature of the loss is going to require more time. If it requires more time and there's a higher rate of emotional up and down, well, then the resiliency itself is going to take more time. So there is an objective element to how resilient an individual is. But there are also various subjective elements, and subjective elements play a much larger role in our recovery itself, in our adjustment itself. So in regards to subjective makeup, some individuals are able to cope and deal with stress, anxiety, and emotion far better than others. It's just a natural spiritual makeup within their mind, within their chemical makeup of their entire body itself. Some individuals are able to go to war and they're able to perform under intense pressure while others break under those types of stresses and so forth. So your subjective emotional makeup plays a large role in how well you're able to adjust. Also, social support. Social support is very key because some individuals have no help whatsoever with their loss. And obviously, there are many secondary losses that occur due to a primary loss. And social support helps those individuals able to continue what they need to do without being on their own. So individuals who are by themselves are going to have a much harder time adjusting to a loss and moving forward than others who don't have individuals to talk to have assistance from, and so forth. So that's very important. Also, an individual's internal and external forms of mourning. Some individuals inherit very bad mourning habits from their family, their parents themselves. And these individuals internalize, they put it to the side, they try to ignore. And in this reality, they're not able to heal as quickly as others who might externalize their grief, who might talk to others, might express it openly, artistically, and so forth. So those who internalize, and many men are guilty of this, those who internalize their grief usually are not as resilient as those who externalize their grief. Faith is also an important factor in determining one's resiliency. Those who are more spiritual usually are able to cope better because they have values beyond themselves, beyond this actual world, and they actually have an idea of an afterlife where the individual is not gone forever themselves. Now, spirituality can also be detrimental because one's worldview can be forever changed and transformed through a loss. One can begin to doubt their faith, doubt their prayer life, doubt God himself. And in these cases, these individuals lose their spirituality and they enter into an existential crisis. But overall, spirituality is an asset for those who are coping and also helping one be more resilient than not in regards to a particular loss. Now, those who aren't religious or spiritual, they still can find various anchors to help them. They might have positive worldviews regarding life itself, positive philosophies, and these philosophies can help them move forward, and they can anchor to these philosophies that have been handed down to them or philosophies that they actually believe. So more positive the worldview, the better the resiliency of the individual themselves. Some individuals fall down and don't get back up. Others have a life philosophy of getting back up and fixing what needs to be fixed. And that, again, goes to the subjective makeup of the individual. Now, bonds are very difficult to break. Attachment theory teaches that an individual from, especially children from birth, they become very attached to their caregiver. And the more strong the bond, the greater the loss and the harder it is to be resilient. Now, there are bonds that can become very unhealthy when one becomes entirely too dependent upon the other individual to the point of a pathology. So when an individual passes away, these bonds are not broken, and these bonds can sometimes become unhealthy, while other times the bonds can still remain healthy, although it has been broken through death itself. So the bonds continue, but they can be healthy or unhealthy. A resilient person can carry on a bond into the next world with an individual through spirituality in a very healthy way, maybe by having prayers said for the individual, or talking to the person when a problem occurs, just in their mind, or visiting the gravesite. This is not pathological. It's in fact healthy for them. It helps them sort their problems out and so forth. However, these types of bonds beyond the grave can become very unhealthy when they prevent resiliency, when they prevent an individual from moving forward, and they can trap the individual within the death and the loss itself. What type of complications are we discussing here? Well, the inability to move on and form new relationships. They're so trapped in the past that they can't form new relationships and meet new individuals. The inability to resume past activities or hobbies. The interest is completely lost for an individual who might have liked to golf in the past. Now they can't even go to a golf course and play the game that they loved so much. It might not be golf. It could be a particular series that they enjoyed watching, and they can no longer watch that particular show. Might be a hobby. I'm an aquarist. I enjoy working with my aquarium, my tank, and so forth. Individuals might lose interest in that particular hobby. Other hobbies include sports, any type of athletics, or any type of collections and so forth, stamp collecting and so forth. So things that used to interest you, you lose interest in, and you have no interest anymore in resuming those particular activities. In essence, you are unable to create a new life narrative. You're unable to incorporate the loss from the past into your present situation and springboard forward into the future. Life is almost like a book where you have different chapters and so forth. An individual who has an unhealthy bond is trapped in a past chapter with the person who passed away, and they're unable to write future chapters of their life story because of this unhealthy bond. And obviously, this is negatively affecting their ability to be more resilient and so forth. Other manifestations include leaving a person's room identical to the way it was when they died and never ever cleaning the room out. So it becomes a museum, but to the individual becomes their own spiritual mausoleum that he cannot escape any longer itself. Some individuals wear clothes of the deceased, which is an extreme pathology. This is not simply a ring or a piece of jewelry to remember the individual by, but literally wearing the clothes and so forth. Hallucinations and excessive dreaming of the individual can also be a sign that the individual is not moving forward. Can individuals experience true spiritual phenomenon? Absolutely. But in many cases, those who have an unhealthy bond with the deceased that aren't able to move forward and form a more healthy bond are experiencing hallucinations, and they need to be seen by a licensed professional in regards to counseling and so forth. So how do certified counselors and licensed professional counselors in grief help form more resilient behaviors? One of the biggest is life view, letting go and moving on, but never forgetting. This is one of the biggest lessons that we can learn in loss. But we have to move on. We have to write our future chapters, but it doesn't mean we forget the past chapters that define us and so forth. So we're not forgetting about the individual, but we are writing new stories of our life as we proceed forward. So that's going to involve having positive outlooks on life itself, being a more less negative about the particular loss, and looking at some of the positives that involve that individual that we lost, past memories, things that we can share with other individuals about that person who passed away, share their beliefs, to teach others what was taught from them to us, and to share those things, those experiences, and just to be overall more positive in our outlook on life. Not everything is negative. Yes, bad things can happen, but life itself isn't bad. And that involves, again, from the previous click, connecting the past, the present, and future narratives. And that's very important to do. And again, also forming strong spiritual connections or some type of philosophical worldview that we can hold forward, going forward with life itself and how we consider our new relationship with the deceased. How do we foster that? How do we remember the individual as we proceed forward? Spiritual people obviously have a belief of reunification in the next life, and that can help them be more resilient and so forth. Physical care of oneself is very important as well. Many who are depressed or are not showing resilient behavior fall into a depression where they no longer care for themselves physically. They don't exercise. They might not even be hygienic. They might not be brushing their teeth or showering. They might just stay in bed and not eat right as well. So getting back into the routine is extremely important in resiliency, being able to move forward and exercise again, to run, to walk, to go to the gym, to groom ourselves properly, and to make sure that we have some pride in our appearance. These are important habits that we have to start forming again after a particular loss. And also resuming old interests, as I mentioned, various hobbies and so forth. They could be anything. And also forming new interests, maybe, new hobbies and new individuals, maybe even meeting new people and so forth. So these are all important ways that we can better form more resilient behaviors as we come out of our grief itself and begin to move on, but not forget. We are the American Academy of Grief Counseling. I'd like to thank you for listening today. Below is a link that we have to our course, our four core courses that you can take to earn our four-year certification. The courses are independent study, and they are open to qualified professionals seeking that certification in grief counseling itself. Our phone number is 330-652-7776. Again, that number is 330-652-7776. And our email is info@aihcp.org. Again, that's info@aihcp.org. Again, thank you for listening, and I hope you have a good day.